Well, over the years on this segment, I've tried my best to cover the year of 1995 in professional wrestling and try and figure out just what went wrong, basically, because both the major companies, WWF and WCW, were not doing well. 1995 is kind of shorthand for shit wrestling in terms of what fans know of the history. So I've been trying to do my best to just see, you know, what's worked and what hasn't worked during this year. And this show, I think, has got a little bit of both, in my opinion. It's time for WCW Starrcade 1995 from December 27th. A rare Wednesday pay-per-view from the Nashville Municipal Auditorium in Nashville, Tennessee. This show was nominated by Allison McManus, Chris Thompson, Tarkan Oren, and Adam Vanderplum over at patreon.com/wrestlingwithregret. The big linchpin for this year's Starrcade is the World Cup of Wrestling, as seven wrestlers from New Japan are invading WCW, in the company's words, to try and take over the company, basically, through this best of seven series. It's all part of the working agreement between the two companies. Eric Bischoff has said this is one of his ways of trying to make WCW appear to be a truly global organization. Bischoff and his longtime associate, Sonny Ono, who you might know as a manager for the company, working together and negotiating with Masa Saito and New Japan to get the deal done. It feels like the promotion for this show is very lacking, or at least the promotion of the World Cup aspect, because watching the Nitros building up to this show from World War III to Starrcade, there's definitely a push by the announcers, oh, World Cup of Wrestling. New Japan wrestlers are coming to check out, you know, to invade and everything. But never once, and unless it's something that's cut out from the network version or the Peacock version of these Nitros, there's no real showing of who we're seeing from New Japan coming to this event. You've got all these big names of the time, and like some future legends, in fact, in Japan, and you know, they're coming there. All we know is that they're coming, but we know nothing about them. There's no highlight packages from them. There's no promos from the Japanese wrestlers. Again, unless this is some kind of copyright issue or something where the network had to take these bits down off the Nitros, there's no real evidence that Japanese wrestlers are coming to WCW unless you listen to the commentary explain it on Nitro. Now, Hulk Hogan is not on this show, and if you're wondering why, it's because he was kayfabe suspended at the end of the year after assaulting officials for 2 weeks in a row. But in reality, though, the deal in his contract only says he works four pay-per-views a year, and he'd worked those already, so this is the way they wrote him out. The show drew a .36 buy rate, 83,000 buys, the second lowest buy rate in company history, though I would assume the Wednesday date had something to do with that. Tony Schiavone, Dusty Rhodes, and Bobby Heenan on commentary, Rhodes promising clubberin' and heine-kicking tonight. Heenan predicts that Ric Flair will win the triangle match and go on to beat Randy Savage for the world title. And look at that oh-so-fancy set. This is the standard pay-per-view set at this time in WCW. A little triangle entrance in the middle of a giant curtain is just class. Also, a fun side story here during the show on commentary is that Bobby Heenan is very much on the take from New Japan. Like, Sonny Ono has been bribing him for weeks, and now he's very much has a financial stake in New Japan winning the World Cup. So if you watch this show for nothing else, watch it to hear Bobby Heenan's commentary and just blatant homerism for the New Japan guys and the way he reacts to every win and loss. It's pretty good. First match in the World Cup sees Chris Benoit, the newest member of the Four Horsemen, taking on Jushin Thunder Liger, who's accompanied by Sonny Ono. He's going to be seen in literally every match on this show except for the last two, so get used to seeing him. Also, I love the fact that Ono's got a giant Japanese flag and Liger has a little Japanese flag. In my opinion, I think Jushin Liger is like the ultimate opening match wrestler. And I mean that, it's not out of disrespect. I'm saying because he's exciting in the ring, he looks and acts unlike almost any other wrestler you'll ever see, and in any case where he's allowed to use his New Japan theme, it's an instant get out of your seat and start cheering song. Because like, dun, 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 dun. It's like the riff and just knowing who it is always gets the crowd popping. And I've seen this, I've witnessed this in person. A few years ago when I went to England for the Wrestling Media Con, a lot of shows I went to that week had Liger on the card. And almost in all those instances, he was the opening match to get the crowd up on their feet from the get-go. And also it's Liger, so yay for that. And so yeah, and we've seen this happen before, Liger just showing up in opening matches across different companies across so many years, and it works. Liger Liger starts off hot with many arm drags and a drop kick and a rolling senton. Benoit taking over and slowing things down, lighting up Liger with some chops, a big German and a kick out. Liger bending Benoit backwards and transitioning to a camel clutch. Benoit drops him from his shoulders. Tombstone attempts are countered. They go up top. Benoit with a big superplex. Of all the superplexes on this night, and there are a few of them, this one gets the biggest pop. More Germans. Benoit hits the flying headbutt as the Taskmaster, Kevin Sullivan, shows up on the apron and talks mess to Benoit. This is all stemming from an altercation between Sullivan and Horseman Brian Pillman on Nitro. Basically, now Benoit is suffering for Pillman's loose cannon actions against the DOD, the Dungeon of Doom. So what happens is Liger, capitalizing with a roll-up, pins and wins the first battle. The first shot is fired in the World Cup. This was a great technical match. These two have great chemistry. They worked a lot in Japan before this, so they knew each other very well, and it showed in the ring. This match was good, but the finisher was really stupid and took some score off this one for me. But be that as it may, a nice appetizer to warm the crowd up for the rest of the night. Gene Okerlund backstage with Eddie Guerrero, who's upset about what happened out there.
Does not set well with you.
No, it doesn't set well at all. Kevin had no reason to be there. That was
he had no business.
No, he didn't.
Yeah, in case you can't tell, 1995 Eddie Guerrero is nowhere nearly as good at promos as, say, 2003 Eddie Guerrero, or even 1998 Eddie Guerrero. It's crazy to see just how much and how well he advanced and how short of a time from coming to WCW. But at this point, still a fresh-faced babyface. He's still fresh off ECW. Hasn't really found his defining character yet. Next match in the series, Alex Wright taking on Koji Kanemoto, who at this time is the IWGP Junior Heavyweight Champion. Kanemoto working Wright's leg early on, but Das Wunderkind comes back, spills to the outside, Wright with a dive. Kanemoto comes back with an elbow, hits some big old kicks. Some struggling over the top rope has Wright running on the outside. Koji with a dive of his own. A tiger suplex and a rope break. The moonsault, and Koji does not go for the cover. Wright's coming back, goes for a missile drop kick. Koji goes to intercept, and neither man really hits each other, and it's a double down. More diving attacks from both men. Each man kicks out. They try the double drop kick spot again. It works slightly better. Wright hits his own missile drop kick just for good measure from the top. Koji with the roll-up wins the match, and now New Japan is up 2-0. I give it 3 stars out of 5. I can appreciate the athleticism in this match and the pace that they worked and the story they told, but I think there was a couple of times too many in this match where they try to go for something and it does not end up working out. It kind of works against it. So, you know, this match for me, kind of in the middle of the road. Mean Gene backstage, plugging the hotline, then interviewing Sonny Ono, who Gene describes as being so happy he's, quote, coming out of his shoes. Ono plans on sweeping WCW, purchasing WCW, then buying the state of Iowa. Okay, there's a funny interaction here at the end.
Was somebody paid off?
No.
Well, wait a minute now. Was somebody paid off? You just say, Ono?
No.
Sonny?
Ono, my name.
Well, Oni. Hey, don't work with me.
We go back to the announce team, and Bobby Heenan on commentary says, well, Japan owns everything else in this country. Why not WCW? Next match in the series sees Lex Luger taking on Masahiro Chono, the former NWA World Champion. Luger, by the way, turned heel a couple of months ago at Halloween Havoc, joining the Dungeon of Doom. Here he gets one of the biggest babyface pops of the night. And that is actually a recurring theme with this show, is that whether a WCW wrestler is face or heel doesn't really matter on this show, because they're all considered babyfaces against the evil foreign menace of New Japan. Luger showing off the strength early on, press slamming Chono. Chono fights back with some big elbows, working him over in the corner. Chono's got Luger in the sleeper and he drops him, gets the STF locked in, but Luger grabs the ropes. Chono with an inverted atomic drop. Luger's selling forever as Chono figures out where he's got to go. He hits the boot, goes for a flying nothing, and Luger hits an elbow. The torture rack, Luger wins, and WCW is finally on the board. The match had some okay moments. There were some good little nuggets in there. I like both guys showing off their power and the striking ability of Chono, but this match was not nearly at the level of the previous two matches we saw. And for its faults that Wright and Kanemoto had, I still think it was a level above, just in terms of overall execution for this one. Mean Gene is now backstage with a stinger. Gene bringing up Sting's history with Kensuke Sasaki and the US title a couple of months ago. Sting saying the title is not on the line here, but pride is, and no way is Sonny Ono going to buy WCW. Then Sting is asked, what's the deal with Lex Luger? Is the question he's been asked repeatedly every single week. There's, oh, what's Sting? You're friends with Lex Luger. What's the deal with him? We are months into this angle now. From the very first Nitro in September when Luger debuts, there's this constant weekly, whose side is he on? What's, who can trust who between Sting and Luger and Macho Man? But all four of these guys are just involved in this big weekly, like, oh my God, the mystery of who allegiances and friendships. Like, it's been going since September. We're at the end of 95 now. Please God, make it stop. In our next World Cup match, the TV champion, Johnny B. Badd, who's with Kimberly the Diamond Doll, taking on Masa Saito. What an absolute mismatch this looks on paper, just in the eyeball test alone. Looks like Badd and Kimberly walked into the wrong soundstage. Sonny Ono on the mic with some good old-fashioned sexism, saying Kimberly belongs in the kitchen, cooking and cleaning. Kimberly calls Sonny Hop Sing. There's a Bonanza reference. Then she asks Sonny what he's doing here, since he says wrestling is a man's sport. Oh shit, she burned him, son! The match gets underway, Saito with some quick takedowns, on the offensive quickly, exchanging some big chops in the two of them. Saito laying into Badd, choking him on the rope. Then Ono chokes Johnny with the flag, more cheating from Ono to help Saito out like he needs it. Badd comes back with some punches, big hang time on the axe handle from the top rope, a sunset flip off the top and a two count. More punches, Saito goes down for a moment, Ono on the apron and Badd grabs him. Saito dumps Johnny over the top rope and the referee disqualifies him, the series now tied at two apiece. Saito staring down Kimberly, but Badd makes the save, dives at him, but kind of overshoots it. I give it 1.5 stars, extra half star, just for the beautiful hang time on Johnny's top rope axe handle here. But yeah, the match had potential, but it wasn't great, and then the very disappointing finish, the disqualification over the top rope thing. Gene's backstage with Jimmy Hart and Lex Luger. What's going on with Kevin Sullivan, Jimmy? Hart's got kind of a non-answer, where he just says Kevin's got a short fuse and the Dungeon of Doom's gonna get it. Luger with a pretty darn good promo here. I would actually say it's one of my favorite promos of his I've listened to in a very long time. Haven't gone out of my way to hear too many Lex Luger promos, but this one does sound like really good and really convincing. He says he is the uncrowned WCW champion. The moment of truth has arrived. He owns Macho Man and is coming for him and his title. He tells Jimmy he's going to go it alone tonight, but Jimmy tells him to bring home some gold, and we'll see how fast this whole thing is upended. Eddie Guerrero taking on Shinjiro Otani, spelled here with two O's for some reason in this next match in the World Cup. Otani here in Young Lions mode based on his gear. Guerrero, like I said, fresh from his time in ECW, relatively, and so he's still kind of the plucky young babyface here. Just compared to like how he was a heel in Mexico to this, it's kind of a stark contrast. Like he's almost kind of a fish out of water. And once he gets a little more ingrained in WCW and lets the heel stuff come through, it will become a big revelation and you'll wonder why they didn't do that from the beginning. But yeah, here, babyface Eddie Guerrero still takes a lot of getting used to. Beginning with some graps, Eddie with a super quick drop kick and the slingshot senton he takes over. A big powerbomb and a brainbuster, but Otani gets out of it. Otani with a big springboard dive to Eddie on the outside. Very physical stuff from these two. The action crescendos with a great Hurricanrana by Eddie. Otani with a leg submission. Guerrero grabs the ropes. Heenan saying the ref should give him a 30 count in the ropes out of kindness. Eddie with a big ass springboard cross body to the outside. Holy crap. Otani with a great looking springboard dropkick to the back of the head. A big old counterfest with the roll ups. Ends with Otani picking up the win. I give it 4 stars out of 5. This is my favorite match of the evening. It barely edges out the Benoit Liger match, and that's only by virtue of this match not having a terrible finish like the opening match did. This was very fun and very much ahead of its time. It's great technical stuff, got the high flying. This is just something, a match you could kind of like put anywhere today and it would still work. It's just very exciting, very fun. And if you don't watch this show just for Heenan's commentary, watch it just for this match. Okerlund's backstage with the WCW champion, Randy Savage, the hardest working champion in WCW at the moment, wrestling every week despite mounting injuries. Gene says he just got off the phone with Hulk Hogan. Of course he did, because Hogan wants to know what frame of mind Savage is in. He goes, "I'm in the zone, yeah." And now it's time for the world champion to take part in the World Cup of Wrestling as he takes on Hiroshi Tenzan, spelled with an S. Tenzan has since gone on to become a multiple-time IWGP heavyweight and tag team champion, but here he's still very much a young guy in his mid-20s here. Like I mentioned, Savage does have a lot of mounting injuries here. He's got an arm injury and he's got a back injury, and he won the championship last month at World War III with all these lingering injuries. Tenzan hits hard, puts a clubber in on Savage in the early going. Randy tries to come back, but Tenzan is just too strong. Just stomping him out. Savage just gets his shit wrecked for a long time here. Tenzan goes for the moonsault, but Savage dodges it and decks him, tries to suplex him over the ropes, but it does not go well, hits the elbow drop and wins. What? Okay. I give this one 1.5 star out of 5. Like, I can get the drama that's built in of Savage now tying up the series 3 apiece, but ugh, this is a very lopsided affair and like completely in an inverse direction of where you thought it was going to go, because Tenzan did maybe 95% of the work in this match. I mean, let's go up a bit and say 90. 96% of the work in this matchup here. Savage, whether or not his arm and back injuries played a role in him saving himself and maybe how that suplex was executed, hard to say, but you know, he did maybe three moves in this match, messing one of them up, and that was the one that Tenzan had to sell before the elbow drop. Neither man looked good at the end of this thing. Meanwhile, on commentary, Bobby Heenan's having quite a time with all this tension of a tie. His slapstick is absolutely gold here. Back to Gene, he says, call Mark Madden, and here's Ric Flair. He tells Sting and Luger that to be the man, they have to beat the man. Then he does this thing in the promo where he's like, Nashville, woo! Dolly Parton on my left! Some other pretty lady on my right! Like, he can't come up with more than one woman of Nashville country?
Dolly Parton to my left! Ha ha! Some better lovely lady to my right!
This one's for all the marbles here. Match 7 of the World Cup of Wrestling as Sting takes on the US champion Kensuke Sasaki, who beat Sting back in Japan to win the belt the previous month. Sting throwing some hands, hits the Stinger splash, goes for it again, but Sasaki stops him cold. Sting comes back and clotheslines Sasaki out of the ring. Back inside, a big power slam and a fisherman's brainbuster by Sasaki. Tenzan with the Scorpion Deathlock on Sting himself, but the Stinger powers out. On Sasaki's shoulders, he slips out and comes back in a big way, gets the Scorpion Deathlock in himself. After much fighting, Sasaki submits and Sting is the winner, WCW winning the World Cup. Then it's time for a very awkward trophy presentation. They really should have rehearsed this a bit more. All the wrestlers from Team WCW, minus Randy Savage, are out there in the ring, and it's a very much a big, you know, yay USA thing against the Japan guys. Even though the first W in WCW is for world, and even though like two of your wrestlers in this team are not from America. Yeah, that noted American, Alex Wright, and that famous American, Chris Benoit. Like, Benoit is like off to the side wearing a horseman shirt. He's not even wearing a team shirt with this one, so he's on the right frame of mind with this one. And so with that, I give the match itself 2.5 stars out of 5. I liked the power on display by Sasaki here. He and Sting were pretty well together. I wish this match were longer. I think these two had something good here, and if it were a bit longer, 3 to 4 minutes, it would have been that much more interesting. And also the storyline of just Sting, you know, being the one to save save WCW and save the World Cup. I think that built-in drama there helped add to it a bit more. But fans in Nashville would get to see more of Sasaki on this show, because after the show goes off the air, we actually get a dart match for the US Championship between he and the One Man Gang. And this is all the result of some crazy just like politics between the US and Japanese companies here, as far as Sasaki not wanting to drop the belt outside of Japan and all this stuff. So this compromise is reached to get the belt off Sasaki back in WCW, where it can be defended more regularly. So you've got this match where the One Man Gang initially wins the match, but there's controversy. The match is restarted and Sasaki wins that second part, walks away with the championship, but according to the lineage, One Man Gang beat Sasaki for the US title, and that was that. So it's very confusing. I mean, each company gets to get what they want here and they can say their own story. But yeah, it's just very weird to see like how that's how they treated the belts back then. Oh, it's kind of fascinating in a way. So now the World Cup is over with, and we can go back to strictly talking WCW business. And in our semi-main event, it's a triangle match to see who will face Randy Savage for the championship right afterward, as Sting takes on Lex Luger and Ric Flair. Like I mentioned, the big story in this matchup is the relationship between Sting and Lex Luger. They are best friends, but Lex Luger is definitely leaning more heel these days. Can he be trusted? Yada yada. So how will these two interact with each other? How will these best friends collide in this match where so much is on the line? Each man has said to the other they will do what they have to do to win this match and become the new champion. Luger has an interesting thread right now. He considers himself the uncrowned world champion because he has beaten Savage and made him tap out to the torture rack many times in the months leading up to this. Then, of course, there is Ric Flair, the 11-time world champion. He's recently reformed the Four Horsemen at Halloween Havoc after blatantly betraying Sting, looking to claim his 12th gold tonight. It's Luger's second match on the night, and Sting's second match in a row comes right back out for this one. Sting and Flair begin the match, not the usual triple threat here. Only two men are legal at a time and one guy's on the outside. Still one fall to a finish, I believe. Sting stings up and overpowers Flair. Some familiar spots between the two of them. Flair dodging a dropkick and begins to take over. Works over Sting for a while until Sting decides to just sting up again. Another press slam, a big superplex. Sting going for the cover, then gets up when he sees Luger coming in. Luger tags himself in and flexes so much he scares Flair out of the ring. Heenan's microphone has clearly died for a while. They're working through that as Luger powers up against the Nature Boy. Cowboy. Flair begins to attack the leg, even softly whacking Luger with a chair when the referee is distracted. The figure four is locked in, and Flair using the ropes to his advantage. Luger does a flex and reverses it. Flair thrown off the top rope, his strikes have no effect. Luger flexing again, the crowd popping less each time. Flair finally tags himself out, and we finally get Sting versus Luger, the friends going at it. Flair getting his first breather in the entire match. Some sportsmanship getting booed by the crowd here. The two are sort of hesitant early on, but Luger is the one who strikes first. Sting firing back on him. Luger back on top with a clothesline out of the corner. Sting coming back, goes for a Vader bomb, but Luger puts up the knees. I'm becoming very distracted by the squeaking sound of the ring at this point. Don't know if it was there the whole time, but I'm definitely hearing it here.
Midsection. Taking Luger now to the post.
Luger breaking out of the Scorpion Deathlock in the ropes, hits a blatant low blow on Sting. Sting recovers, hits the Stinger Splash, but missing the second. The torture rack is applied, but the ref's taken out with Sting's boot. Flair gets in the ring and attacks Luger's leg, throwing Sting out of the ring. Both guys are outside now. Flair reviving the ref, and now the ref starts to count out. Sting almost gets back in, but Luger pulls him back out, and Flair wins. I'm gonna give it 2 stars out of 5. There were some good bursts in this matchup here. I thought the finish was pretty clever, but I think this match went on a bit too long for its own good. And go call me too new school, but I do not like this format of a three-man. I think that having Flair spend most of the match just on the outside, and before it was like Sting or Luger, just the one guy sitting out there letting the whole thing happen, that to me seems pretty passive, and I think it's much more interesting if all three guys are legal at the same time. Just Flair standing on the apron for most of this match, not a recipe for excitement in my opinion. Then Jimmy Hart, who has just been managing Lex Luger this entire time and has been feuding with the Four Horsemen, faves Luger and celebrates with Flair and manages him for this next match. Okay, let's just roll with it. WCW title in your main event as Randy Savage defense against Ric Flair. Of course, these two have a big history, not just their stuff in the World Wrestling Federation, but 1995 itself could be defined by the Flair-Savage rivalry. We talked about it before on this channel with the Great American Bash and Bash at the Beach, all stemming from the fact that Flair and Arn Anderson beat up Angelo Poffo, Savage's dad. The match is underway. Mott starts off with lots of punches. It's clear he was saving himself with Tenzon, because even though he still doesn't do a ton here, it's still a lot more than in his last match. Paul Orndorff shows up in a neck brace, but he's escorted to the back. The reason he's there is he was beaten up by the Horseman, Brian Pillman. Again, stirring shit up for the Horseman here. He pile drove Orndorff onto the concrete floor a couple weeks ago on Nitro, laid him out as Paul's in-ring career is actually coming to an end in real life. Savage goes for bombs away, but Flair takes him out in midair, attacking the arm with the ring post, working it back in the ring. Savage begins to come back, hits the backdrop and some clotheslines. We get a 2 count. Jimmy Hart tries to give Flair the megaphone, but the attack backfires. Savage lightly dinking Flair in the head, but that's enough to cause quite the gusher. Flair looks pretty gross here, bleeding profusely. In come Brian Pillman and Chris Benoit, the Horsemen, to show up, but Savage fights them off. Arn Anderson decking the Macho Man with the referee distracted. Flair covers and wins to regain the title for a record 12th time. Pillman takes the belt and just beats Savage with it. Still no clue what the hell Jimmy Hart's doing there with them. And we get one more recap of the show as we fade to black. I give this match 1 star out of 5. This is not the best encounter between Savage and Flair, because Savage, like I mentioned, is already working hurt. These guys have now wrestled one match already going into this thing. Flair's blade job was unnecessary and excessive, even by Ric Flair standards. It was a bit much. And yeah, screwy finish overall. This match was not the best way to end this show, I think. My grade for WCW Starrcade 95 is a D+. And one thing I'll say is something I've said and alluded to frequently covering this time period in WCW. Guys like Chris Benoit and Eddie Guerrero doing the heavy lifting and helping save this show from becoming total bunk. There are some interesting things on this show. There's some decent matches, and there's 2 great ones, the ones I mentioned, Benoit and Liger, Otani and Guerrero. But there's also a lot of not great stuff in this show, and a lot of that unfortunately circles around the main event picture and the fact that Savage is working hurt and has still wrestled 2 matches on this night. And the triangle match, I don't think it was that great. The main event was worse, sadly. And the World Cup was just not executed all that well. And Bischoff has said in interviews how he wanted the World Cup to become an annual tradition. Obviously, it didn't work out. I think you can do World Cup stuff. I don't think it's impossible. I think that there's a great way you could tell that story of having like international wrestlers from different companies come down and like they, you know, have these big battles and stuff. TNA has done great World Cups in the past, and so or similar things to that. So it can be done. So, but this one, WCW, didn't work out. It had interesting legs, but I don't think it was promoted well on TV from what I saw, and it wasn't executed well on pay-per-view. If you want to play a role in determining which shows I look at, be they good, bad, or somewhere in between, go to patreon.com/wrestlingwithregret, become a $10 backer or above, and you'll have the chance to nominate classic shows for me to review. Next time, we're going to the year 2001, at the beginning of a very pivotal time in wrestling history. Somewhere out of the ashes of WCW rises a new WCW for a new age. I'm talking about King of the Ring 2001. I'm Brian Zane, and I'll see you next time.